Church online. We are really glad you could join us today. In Psalms 145 verse 7, King David says this, "Everyone will share the story of your wonderful goodness. They will sing with joy about your righteousness." And this morning, we are going to do just that. Wherever we are, let's begin to sing unto the Lord and let's begin to lift our voices to Him. Thank you, Jesus. Worship and adore you this morning. And so God, we pray, God, that if any of us are downcast this morning, that as we look to you, oh God, we will find strength and hope in the name of Jesus. And in your precious name we pray. All of God's people say amen. Let's praise God this morning.
Goodness never stops. Your mercy follows me. You are. Blessed Sunday, everyone. A very warm welcome to Elimites and friends who have joined us in our online service this morning. If you are joining us for the first time, we want to extend a special welcome to you. I am certain our God of love will surround you with His everlasting love. It is great to have you with us this morning. Deuteronomy chapter 16 verse 17 says, "Every man shall give as he is able according to the blessings of the Lord your God which he has given you." We give because he first gave us. And as we give our tithes and offering to the Lord this morning, let us give with a cheerful and a grateful heart. Join me as we pray over the tithes and offerings. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for your tremendous love and grace towards us. Lord, indeed we are forever grateful to you for all that you have done for us, for your provisions, for your blessings, for your guidance, for your protection. And even this morning as we give unto you our tithes and offerings, God, I pray that, Lord, may you use it for the furtherance of your kingdom, for your glory, for your purpose. Thank you, Lord. We bless you in Jesus' most precious and gracious name we pray. Amen. And now, for our family life message, I will hand the time to Pastor Wilson Pang.
Good morning, church. As we continue on the topic of parenting in the month of November, and so for this week, we want to encourage all the parents out there, including myself, intentional and Christ-based parenting by making godly deposits into your child's life. The principle of sowing and reaping is rewarding. And we love this word, reward. And Paul wrote in the book of Colossians, especially in chapter 3, when he's addressing to those living in Christian home. And so in Colossians chapter 3, verses 23 and 24, and this is what he has written. "Whatever you do, work at it with all your heart as working for the Lord, since you know that you will receive an inheritance from the Lord as a reward." Once again, the word reward. And so I want to encourage all the parents out there today, make godly deposits into your child's life by sowing a good value such as respecting your spouse, the elderly, or even everyone at home. How about godly deposits in encouragement or render assistance to someone who's in need, or even applaud a good behavior, or many other ways of instilling godly character into your child's life. And so have a fun-filled week ahead as you make godly deposits into the memory bank of your child, because you will be rewarded. Amen.
Like to attend the MM and want to hear the various testimonies from the members, and through this I'm inspired by God to come regularly and to attend.
I love attending MM because there's a day where I go to be with all the other brothers and sisters to worship God and also I am ministered by God in during the MM with all that is going on. Normally when I go to MM, I go with a lot of things up in my head or in my heart, but it's there where God, I meet up with God and God minister to me in MM.
A strong church is only as strong as a prayer life, and I count it a blessing to pray with others.
I learned to pray for others and I became bolder at doing that during prayer meetings. Also, listening to other people's testimonies greatly encouraged me. If God can do it for them, He can do it for me also.
Join us at our Miracle Moments this Wednesday, 7:30 p.m. online. Do note that concurrently, our children will also be having their eKids Miracle Moments online. So please approach Pastor Jean or Pastor Celine for more details. And now, it is my pleasure to invite our preacher for this morning. You and I are in for a treat, and I'm sure all of us will be greatly blessed and challenged by the preaching of God's Word. So let us welcome Pastor Derek Fu. Pastor Derek.
A very warm welcome to all of you who are tuning in and watching today. Indeed, it is a great joy that you are able to join us today. Now, I thank God for this opportunity to share the Word of God with all of you. And so I would like us to begin in prayer as we prepare our hearts and believe for God to minister and speak to us wherever that we are. And so let's bow our heads, close our eyes, and let's pray. Father God, I just thank you once again for the many who are watching this broadcast. Indeed, no matter the time or the place, Lord, you are always there with us. And so as we hear and engage with your word, I ask for your Holy Spirit to illuminate the word and to bring life and light into our hearts. And so, Lord, we prepare ourselves and we are ready to receive your word for us. So we thank you, Father, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You know, I just want to say that I was mulling over and thinking about what to share this week, and I was still uncertain of the direction that this message was going to take. But I thank God for the message that Pastor Glenn, our senior pastor, preached over this pulpit last week, as it provided a confirmation as to what I was going to share. You know, there's no collaboration of any sort about what to preach on. And so it is really amazing and encouraging to see how God weaves His direction for His people as we remain faithful to Him. Last Sunday, Pastor Glenn gave us the message about staying connected to Jesus. We must desire to stay connected to Jesus, to stay connected to the vine. And through Jesus, we will exhibit fruitfulness in our lives. And as a follow-up to that message, I would like us to be encouraged today to live in the fullness of Christ. Our passage today is taken from Colossians chapter 2, verses 6 to 10. You know, some background first. The city of Colossae was located on an important highway at the time. And so there was a very diverse Gentile population there and also included a substantial number of Jews. Now, because of this diversity, many religious and philosophical viewpoints thrived and likely converged and mixed together. And it is likely due to this syncretism of religious ideas that affected the Christians in Colossae. The Apostle Paul wrote this letter to the Colossians in order to address some of the false teachings that had permeated and impacted them. And so from our passage, I would like to highlight 3 points that will lead us to live in the fullness of Christ. The first is the command. The command is to live in Christ. Paul instructs the Colossians and us as well today in verses 6 and 7. So then, just as you have received Christ Jesus as Lord, continue to live your lives in Him, rooted and built up in Him, strengthened in the faith as you were taught, and overflowing with thankfulness. Right, Paul tells us how we should continue to live in Christ. We must first be rooted and built up. When we come to know and accept Jesus into our lives as our Lord and Savior, we become rooted in Him. We must be rooted like a tree, growing deep roots into the ground. The deep roots provide strength and stability so that the tree continues to stand tall even after being battered by strong winds and fierce storms. The roots also provide nourishment to give life to the tree and thereby life and shelter to its inhabitants. Therefore, to live in Christ is to be rooted in Christ, the life-giving soil. It is reminiscent of what the psalmist writes in Psalm chapter 1, verse 3. That person, the person who believes in Christ, the person who meditates on the Word of God, who is rooted in the Word of God, that person is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever they do prospers. The other descriptive pair, other than to be rooted, is to be built up. This architectural term gives us a picture of a building with a solid foundation. Jesus also tells us in the parable in Matthew chapter 7, verses 24 to 26. Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine, who is rooted in the word of Christ and puts them into practice, is like a wise man who built his house on a rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against the house. Yet it did not fall because it had its foundation on the rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice is like a foolish man who built his house on sand. You see, it is only with this solid foundation that a tall building can be built. Skyscrapers can stand tall because they have a strong and a deep foundation that can withstand raging winds at high altitudes or the seismic activity that can occur. The world's tallest building, the Burj Khalifa, stands at over 828 meters tall and more than 160 stories. For it to stand, it had to use over 45,000 cubic meters of concrete, weighing over 110,000 tons for the concrete and the steel foundation on which this building sits. Similarly, we can stand tall amidst the storms when we are built up on Christ, the sustaining foundation. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 5 tells us that you also, like living stones, are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. Therefore, as Christians, we are attached to Christ the vine, and God desires for us to be fruitful and also to integrate us like stones into the new structure that is the body of Christ. Secondly, as we continue to be rooted and built up, we will be established or strengthened in our faith. You know, to be established or strengthened is to be firm, to be stable, to hold fast, and to not let go. And where does this strength come from? The scripture tells us it comes from learning about God. As we discover who God is and what He can do, our faith is established, our faith is strengthened. So we can continue to live in Christ when we study the Word, when we study what we've been taught, whether be it through the sermons or our Christian education classes or through interactions in our care cells, through our miracle moments prayer meetings, or in our social gatherings with mature believers. As we continue to learn more about God, we grow and we are strengthened in our faith. So do not underestimate the importance of studying the Word of God together and of meeting together. And the third way in verses 6 and 7 to live in Christ is to overflow with thanksgiving. With Christ having done so much for us, how can we not be grateful and thankful? So never stop giving thanks to God. Let thanksgiving overflow in us to become praise to God every moment of our day. And that is why Paul can write in Philippians chapter 4, in verses 4 and 6, "Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say, rejoice." And in verse 6, "Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God." So the command for us today is to continue to live in Christ. However, Paul does not stop there. He knows of the threat that was facing the Colossian church, and it's also what we face today. What is this threat? The threat of falsehoods. Colossians chapter 2, verse 8, "See to it that no one takes you captive through hollow and deceptive philosophy, which depends on human tradition and the elemental spiritual forces of this world rather than on Christ." You see, brothers and sisters, all of us, all Christians, we face this danger of false teachers and false doctrines. And Paul warns us, "See to it." Other translations use the words, "Be careful, take heed, beware." It is not something that we should take lightly because it can take us captive. Right? The Greek verb used here is to mean to take complete control, just as someone is carried off as a prisoner of war. These false teachings seek to ensnare the believer and snare us away from the truth and into the slavery of error. What are the characteristics of this false teaching? Very briefly, first, this philosophy or teaching is hollow and deceptive. Hollow or empty means that there is no intellectual, moral, or spiritual value. It is without content, without any basis, without truth, and without power. Deceptive means that its motivation has nothing to do with Christ. Rather, it is based on things such as wealth, desire, fame, and power. Second, it is based on human tradition. When we read through Colossians, you find that they were dealing with teachers who stressed the observance of Jewish holy days and obedience to certain traditional rules. About this, I would like to share a little story. You know, a girl was watching her mother prepare a fish for dinner. Her mother cut off the head and the tail of the fish and then placed it into a baking pan. Right? You know, the head and the tail. For us Chinese, we eat the whole fish. So the little girl asked her mother why she cut off the head and the tail of the fish. So her mother thought for a while and then said, "I don't know. I've always done it that way. That's how grandma always did it." Not satisfied with the answer, the little girl went to visit her grandma to find out why she had cut off the head and tail of the fish before baking it. Grandma thought for a while and then replied, "I don't know. My mother always did it that way." So the little girl and the grandma went to visit great-grandma to find out if she knew the answer. Great-grandma thought for a while and said, "Because my baking pan was too small to fit the whole fish." You see, sometimes we need to examine some of the traditions that we are following and to determine if we are just following blindly without knowing the reasons behind it. In the situation in Colossae, the observance of traditions such as circumcision diminished the value of Christ's redemptive work on the cross that redeemed us from the penalty of our sin and made us righteous before God. The third characteristic of this false teaching was that it was focused on the elemental spiritual forces of this world. The syncretic teachings brought focus on the material elements, be it earth, the water, fire, wind, the stars, the moon, and the sun, and etc., and lowered Christ to the level of these lesser deities. Are there falsehoods that we are facing today? Sure. We must admit that we are gullible people that are attracted to catchy headlines, bold claims, and incredible stories. The Minister for Communications and Information, S. Iswaran, said in Parliament in May that since January, about 40 instances of speculation, rumors, scams, and outright falsehoods about the coronavirus outbreak have been debunked by government agencies. You see, we must be very careful about the material that we are receiving and what we are sharing as well. Are there false doctrines that the church is dealing with? Of course, we have false teachers, false prophets, false teachings and doctrines. Now they are more rampant than ever because they are now more accessible than ever. The online church has helped us reach out to people who can't come to church, who are homebound, and even those who are located outside of Singapore, just like some of you are watching. And at the same time, it has made us more susceptible and more exposed to false teachers, false teachings, and doctrines. Don't fall prey to them. Don't let them ensnare you and trap you. Always check what you hear with the source. That is the Word of God and God Himself. What then is the solution to this threat? For this, Paul issues the reminder to all of us as believers, you are complete in Christ. Verses 9 and 10 of our passage. For in Christ all the fullness of the deity lives in bodily form. And in Christ you have been brought to fullness. He is the head over every power and authority. See, Paul builds his case beginning with Jesus Christ. In fact, the whole thrust of the book of Colossians is that Jesus Christ possesses the fullness of God, that He has power and authority over all things. Paul provides this overarching theological premise in Colossians chapter 1, verses 15 to 20. The Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For in Him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities. All things have been created through Him and for Him. He is before all things, and in Him all things hold together. And He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything He might have supremacy. For God was pleased to have all His fullness dwell in Him, and through Him to reconcile to Himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through His blood shed on the cross. You see, brothers and sisters, Christ is God Himself in an absolute, full, and perfect sense. Jesus Christ has the full nature and being of God, just as God the Father has the full nature of God. Fullness means that not a single part of God's nature is lacking in the nature of Christ. Jesus had the fullness of the divine nature even before He came to earth. John chapter 17, verse 5, Jesus says, "And now, Father, glorify me in your presence with the glory I had with you before the world began." Paul also spoke of Jesus as being in very nature God. Jesus had the fullness of the divine nature when He walked on this earth as well. John chapter 1, verse 18, "No one has ever seen God, but the one and only Son, who is Himself God and is in closest relationship with the Father, has made Him known. And now in heaven, He is seated at the right hand of the throne of God and given full authority to rule and to reign." So you see, the fullness of God is in Christ. Because of Jesus being fully man and fully God, He is the only perfect Lamb of God that is able to rescue and save us. Praise God. But Paul didn't stop there. He continues in verse 10. In Christ, you have been brought to fullness. He is the head over every power and authority. See, divine fullness establishes Christ's superiority beyond doubt. And with this superiority, we are filled with Him who brings us to fullness, who completes us and is able to meet our every need. Paul assures us that we have this fullness as we continue in verses 11 and 12. In him, you were also circumcised with a circumcision not performed by human hands. Your whole self ruled by flesh was put off when you were circumcised by Christ, having been buried with him in baptism, in which you were also raised with him through your faith in the working of God who raised him from the dead. As believers, know today that you and I, we are in Christ, and therefore are with Christ in his death, in his burial, and in his resurrection. And Christ can hold all the fullness of deity. We can't. But believers, we are full of his fullness. What does this mean? It means that all that humanity can know or experience of God is found in Christ. And we as believers, we can have access to all this knowledge and all these experiences. We do not need to look elsewhere for this knowledge. We do not need to look elsewhere for this experience. See, the church in Colossae were enticed by false teachers and false prophets who claimed a higher power and a higher knowledge beyond what is taught in Scripture. In today's context, you can search for prophets on YouTube, and there are plenty. They claim a supernatural and spiritually closer link with God, that God has revealed intimate secrets and prophecies to them. We don't need to go to them. We have the fullness of Christ in us. And we can have direct access to God. Check with the source. You know, I like this quote by John Bloom. God tells us everything we need to know exactly when we need to know. Now, I'm not discounting the prophetic ministry. Please don't get me wrong. Prophetic ministry is part of the fivefold ministry of the local church. And so they are important. We need them in the church. But whatever we receive from the prophetic, whatever we receive from other people, other ministers, it is our responsibility to reflect on it with the Word of God as our guidepost. Not only do we have this knowledge and experience, but we also have access to Christ, the head of every power and authority. So don't subscribe to a half dose of his goodness, a half dose of his power. You know, my wife Hui Min doesn't like to take medicine. She's healthy and strong, so she doesn't need to take medicine very often. She doesn't fall sick often as well. Still, we all get the occasional pains, the occasional headaches. You know, if you go to the polyclinic and get pain relief medications such as Panadol and paracetamol, the pharmacist will usually advise you to take 2 tablets every 4 to 6 hours. Now, Hui Min is the type that will take only 1 instead of 2. She's of the mindset that, you know, it's not that painful, I can still bear it, I just need to take 1 pill. Me, I'm the 2-tablet kind of guy, right? I will take what I know for sure will work instead of just 1 tablet, in case it's not enough. And sometimes I think we are like that with God too. We sometimes ask for just enough. I just need help this much. I just need help in this area. I just need to know this much about what I need to do next. I just need you to heal me here, and the rest I can manage on my own. I will say this again, we have the fullness of God in us. Ask for the fullness of God in your situation and your circumstance, because he is more than able to do it. And so have faith in God that he can. So through the scripture today, we are reminded to live in Christ, look out and beware of falsehoods, and be mindful of the fullness of Christ in us. The question and the challenge that begs us today is this: are you living in the fullness of Christ? Are you rooted and established in him? Are you rooted and established in Jesus, with him as the solid rock and foundation of your life? For those watching today, they are not believers. Maybe you're watching with a family member who is Christian. You know, God has made it so that you are watching this right now. It is not by chance or by coincidence. It is a divine arrangement because God wants you to listen to this message. You see, God is not far off in outer space somewhere. He is a God who is concerned with His precious creation. And that's you and me. He loves you and I so much that He does not want to leave us on our own. He revealed Himself through His Son, Jesus Christ, whom we have been talking about. His precious Son came to the earth over 2,000 years ago to show us who God is and how much God loves us. Yes, for God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son, that whosoever would believe in Him would not perish, but have eternal life. Jesus Christ died so that we don't have to. But He didn't stay dead. Jesus rose again on the third day and is alive forevermore. Likewise, Jesus offers you this eternal life today. He offers you the opportunity to live in His fullness today and to live with Him in eternity forever. Today, I invite you to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and personal Savior. And when you do, He will be the rock and foundation of your life for you to grow and to be fruitful in Him. For the rest of us, are you living in the fullness of Christ? Have you placed Christ in a box, only thinking that He can help you in one way or in a certain way, but not in others? Have you been depending on your own strength and not relying on His power and His might? Today, magnify Christ. Magnify Him above your problems, above your circumstances, above the issues of life, and walk in faith and confidence in the fullness of Christ that is in you. Live in the fullness of Christ today. Let us bow our heads and close our eyes. Let's pray. I first want to pray for those of you who have the desire to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. All it takes for you is to say a simple prayer, to ask Jesus to be your Lord and Savior, and Jesus will answer your prayer. He will be available always, anytime, just a prayer away, and He will help you grow in your relationship with Him. And so if you want to make this decision, then do repeat this prayer after me. And if there are Christians around, do pray along to encourage them. And so repeat this prayer after me. Say, "Dear God, I thank You for loving me. I admit that I am a sinner and I cannot save myself. Please forgive me. I believe that Jesus came and died on the cross for my sins. I believe He rose again to give me a new life. I accept Jesus Christ now as my Lord and Savior. I surrender my life to You. Lead me and direct me so that I may live this new life to glorify You. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen." Let me pray for you now. Father, I thank You for those who have responded to this prayer. Lord, for those who have made this wise decision to accept You as their Lord and their Savior. I come against the spiritual work of the enemy, of the evil one, who would seek to distract, who would seek to detract, who would seek to deceive my brother and my sister to turn away from You. I pray, O Lord, that You shield them and protect them from all harm and danger and evil. Lord, guide them, Lord, by Your Holy Spirit, and lead them so that they will continue to grow in this new relationship with You. Yes, I commit them into Your hands. And so we thank You, Father, and we rejoice with them. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen and amen. And if you prayed that prayer with all your heart, I welcome you to the family of God. We rejoice with you just as the angels in heaven are rejoicing as well. We want to keep in touch with you. And so if you're watching on our live streaming website, do click on the live prayer button and one of our pastors will be able to chat and pray with you. And if you're watching on our other social media platforms such as YouTube or Facebook, please leave a comment down below or drop us an email at general.office@elamchurch.org.sg. And we would love to get in touch with you, send you some resources, and help you in this new journey, in this relationship with God. For the rest of us, I would like us to respond to the Word of God this morning. You know, as God gave me this message, a song came to mind, and I thought it was a very appropriate song for us to close this message in response to the Word of God. Let us respond to Him in this song, and you can respond to the Lord how, wherever that you are, and begin to worship Him as we magnify Him this morning. Thank you, Jesus.
I have made you too small in my eyes, oh Lord, forgive me, and I have believed in the lie that you were unable to help me. Be magnified, O Lord. You are highly exalted, and there is nothing you can't do. Be magnified. glorified, oh Lord. You are highly exalted, and there is nothing you can't do. Fullness of God, Kuria Ramasandria, thank you, Jesus, thank you, Lord. Kuria Ramasuria Ramaramai, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus, thank you, God.
Father, I just thank you, Lord, for this morning. I thank you for your word for us today. Lord, thank you for reminding us that we have the fullness of Christ in us. We have full, unhindered access to your knowledge, to your provision, to your power, and to your authority. God, because Christ is in us. Lord, forgive us. Lord, for taking you for granted, for taking you lightly, for having a diminished view of your power, your authority, and your ability. Lord, we want to magnify you. Indeed, be magnified over our situations. Be magnified over our difficulties. Be magnified over our trials. Be magnified over every aspect of our lives, O God. May we live with a magnified vision of you, so that everything else pales in comparison to who you are and what you can do. Thank you for the glorious privilege of giving you glory and magnifying you through our lives, O God. And we will do so in the fullness of your authority and power, so that we can live victoriously as salt and light in this world. So thank you, Lord, once again for speaking to us. I pray, Lord, for your blessing upon every person watching and listening. Lord, empower and anoint us to shine for you, O God, helping us to be who you want us to be and to do what you want us to do. We give you all praise and all glory. In Jesus' mighty name we pray, and everyone declares, say, amen, hallelujah. Give him a good praise offering this morning. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen. And so I urge you, click on the heart icon, give us a thumbs up, leave us a comment if you are blessed in our service today. And so have a victorious week ahead, living in the fullness of God. God bless you.